the tower, and the system that we are going to talk about right now, that is the yaw system, actually resides here. So this part is what we are going to talk about, and that is the yaw system. So what is the work of the yaw mechanism? So a turbine, a wind turbine, has two controls or 2 degrees of freedom of rotation. So it can rotate on, so when the wind comes, the turbine blades rotate. That's the only motion that we can see. And that is causing the generation to happen. But there are 2 other degrees of freedom which can be controlled, and that leads to optimum generation. So the first one is the pitch mechanism, that is the blades of the turbine could be controlled, and the second is the yaw mechanism. So when we were kids, if we had this, the table fan which rotates, which has that oscillation of 180 degrees, what would we do? We would go and, keep following the motion of that fan so that we get the wind, right? So basically, yaw mechanism exactly does that. So it turns the plane of rotor of the turbine in the direction of the wind so that it is perpendicular and it generates the maximum power. So what is yaw misalignment? So when the wind direction, so what we are seeing here, the blue direction, the blue line is the direction in which the wind is coming, and the turbine rotor plane is supposed to be perpendicular, exactly perpendicular to that. If it is not, then it will receive only the cosine component of the wind, not all of the wind. And that leads to, the lowering of the generation that could happen at that particular angle and wind speed. And the second thing is it causes mechanical stress on the structure of the turbine. And this significantly reduces the lifetime of a turbine. So these are the reasons why looking at yaw misalignment is an important problem and it needs to be solved. So the problem statement would be this: identify turbines with faulty yawing mechanism and what are the actions that needs to be taken so that those faults are corrected. So first let's talk about the traditional approach. So there are site engineers deployed at wind power plants, and what is the traditional approach that they would take? First is the visual inspection to identify a jammed yaw. So here I've just put an image where the first turbine is facing another wind direction, whereas the second and third turbine are facing another wind direction. So this is the kind of identification that a site engineer can do. So by visual inspection, it is very apparent that the first turbine yaw is not proper, and the second and third turbine's yaw is fine because, like, you know, one could be faulty and two could be good. So this is a visual inspection that they could do. And the second is live monitoring of generation. So there are SCADA systems that are installed on these turbines, and they let the data to be collected. And by live monitoring of generation, depending on the wind speed, is the power generated optimal or not? So these are the two ways that we've known the site engineers to be, doing the identification of yaw misalignment. The first, in the first case, it's actually very late. The motor would already be jammed or something by the time it is identified visually. And the second is not a really very accurate method because there could be so many reasons why the power generation is not optimal. It cannot be attributed to one single reason. So, here is a proposal of an algorithm that will help identify the turbines with that faulty mechanisms and also the actions that need to be taken. So this algorithm is actually divided into 4 stages, where the first is detection of the presence of this fault in the turbine. Second is identifying the root cause of it, and quantifying the energy lost. So unless there is a quantification of how much energy has been lost due to this fault, there might not be corrective actions that would be taken. So the third stage is important. And fourth and final stage is actually recommending the corrective action. So how do we detect yaw misalignment? It's like, so since we know from theory that the plane of the blades should be exactly perpendicular to the direction of the wind, so we look at the wind direction and the yaw angle data that comes in. So the difference between these two should be zero. So, and if it is not, and if it is not for a persistent amount of time, that is when this gets detected. Now, coming to the identification of root cause of why the yaw misalignment has happened. Once it is detected that it is there, the next stage is to identify the root cause. So that is that could be due to three reasons. So first is sensor malfunction, miscalibration, or incorrect yawing speed. So a sensor malfunction is where the data is either getting captured incorrectly, and that's why the data seems to say that the sensor is not functioning properly, or the sensor is actually not working. So here is a clear example where this kind of plot is called a wind rose, and this shows the velocity of the wind and the direction in which it is coming from. So if we look at the data for the nacelle position and the wind direction of one turbine, the wind direction seems to be coming from a lot of directions, which is the natural way that it should come up. It should be, and the nacelle position is always pointing to one direction. So this is a clear indication that the sensor is either not working or we're getting the data wrongly. Second is sensor miscalibration. This happens when there is a zero point error. That is, the zero of the sensor is not aligned exactly with the zero. So whenever we check the difference between the wind direction and the yaw angle, there is always a finite difference. And that is a clear signature of a miscalibrated sensor. The third thing is incorrect yaw speed. So the yawing of the turbine, the speed at which the wind direction changes, the yawing of the turbine also happens at that rate. But this model is to identify. So here is the first step where we are implementing an ML technique. So this step is to identify if the yawing mechanism of the turbine is either lazy or hyper. So by lazy, it's not as quick as it should be. By hyper, we mean that it is too quick, and it is not reaching a stable state, and it is too quick, and the generation is never reaching its optimum. So to identify this, there is a, so the model that is implemented is that it learns the yaw speed. So during ideal conditions, at what rate of change of wind speed is the yawing happening? So that is the ideal condition that it, that the regression model learns. And then it constantly, the model is deployed in production and it constantly predicts the yaw speed. So if that yaw speed, the actual and predicted are not aligned, that is to say that the yawing of the turbine is not happening at the rate at which a healthy turbine yaws. So if it is slower than the predicted, then it is a lazy turbine. If it's faster, then it's a hyper turbine. And both these cases lead to suboptimal generation. So this plot here shows that this is a constant, the yellow part of the area plot shows the constant time when the yaw misalignment is existing, and the red part of the plot shows that at that time when the yaw misalignment was there, there was also power curve deviation. So just to talk a little bit about the terminology used here, power curve is a standard plot that is used in a wind turbine. So that is the expected power that needs to be generated at any given wind speed. So when a turbine is manufactured and set up and commissioned at a site, so there at a given wind speed at that location, what is the expected power that needs to be generated? So the red part of the plot is showing what is the deviation of that power curve from the actual. So this shows that when the yaw misalignment was there, there was also suboptimal power generation. So now we have identified the root cause of the yaw misalignment. The next stage is quantification of the energy lost. And why is this important? So a wind farm is actually owned by somebody, maintained by somebody else. So when there is a recommendation that says there needs to be a corrective action to be taken. The person who maintains the wind farm needs to be convinced and needs to be given proper data points to, there should be enough prerogative for them to go and take an action for it. Minor yaw misalignments or minor any errors would not be taken any action for. And just to avoid that, or just to provide a data point for that, this is the step which does the quantification of energy lost. So if there is a data point that says this much energy is being lost because of particularly due to misalignment, then that is a prerogative for them to go check the yaw mechanism. So how is this done? Here is another ML model. It's a nonlinear regression model that is implemented, but it could be any other model as well. So since it works here, so the green line here is the standard power curve. So when a turbine is commissioned, this is the standard power curve that is given for that turbine, and the red points are the actual power that is recorded from the data. And we see that there is a clear deviation after between 1250 and 1500, the power is sort of flattening out, which is not expected of a healthy turbine. And it was checked that it is actually not a curtailment case, so that is ruled out. And so when such cases are pointed out, so we need to have the quantification. So the nonlinear regression model, what it does is it learns the ideal active power. So the green line that is given by the turbine manufacturer is kind of an ideal thing. So it would be given when the turbine is commissioned, but then over the years the performance degrades, and with varying air density that changes. So there is a nonlinear regression model trained to learn all of that, the individual turbine's performance and the variations with respect to wind air density. All of that is learnt by the model, and the ideal active power is predicted. When an yaw misalignment case is identified and then this model is run on it, the difference of that energy is attributed to yaw misalignment. So now that we have a data point which says this much is the energy lost, the next action that needs to be taken is the corrective action. So in the past, we have the maintenance data which says for so-and-so issue, maintenance was done on the yaw mechanism. So with all of that historical data, and at the time when those maintenances were done, what is the SCADA data? So what is the raw data telling us? So this is a maintenance data. That data combined with the generation and the SCADA data, at that time, what actually was happening with the other yaw related data. So that all of that data is given to a third machine learning model here, which turns out to be the decision tree. This decision tree is basically given two inputs. One, that is the root cause of the stage two of the algorithm, that is identification of the root cause. So that is X, and Y is the quantification of energy. So these two are given as inputs to the decision tree, and the historical maintenance data at that time is taken to get the time period when the data needs to be looked at. So from these, a decision tree is trained to provide recommendations. So now this is from the historical data. On the current data, so once the data is passed through all the three stages, the decision tree of the stage four gives out the recommendation of the proper action that needs to be taken to do the corrections to the yaw misalignment. And the most important part here is supersede historical judgments if necessary. So in the history, so if currently the data is showing that there could be a potential yaw misalignment or a yaw failure that could happen, but in the historical data, there was nothing of that sort ever seen before. So what do we do in such cases? So then human intervention comes into picture. So from the data, we know that these are the probable recommendations when we know it has happened in the past. But when we encounter situations which are totally different from what has if required. And just to talk about the results, so with the implementation of this algorithm, the energy generation losses were brought down from 12% to 7% at one of the farms that this algorithm was implemented. And with data and with machine learning, I just wanted to show how a single particular problem could be solved. So this is also to demonstrate how very simple machine learning algorithms could lead to really useful and real life implementable solutions. So there are also use cases where you know, deep network or deep learning and all of that is used, but I just wanted to show a use case where very simple machine learning techniques have had a real impact. Thank you. I'm open to questions. Any questions? I'm open to questions.
You did not cover the detection part in, you know, in completeness, as in how do you detect that there is a yaw misalignment?
Yaw misalignment is basically like the wind direction and the nacelle position should always be aligned. So the data of the two is looked at, and if there is a difference between the two angles, that is a case for yaw misalignment. So
you get that data?
Yeah, so we get the direction data for.
So it's already there, as in?
As different tags. Yeah. We just, I mean, it's not just the direct difference of these two tags. There are something called the cut in wind speed. I'll just go back. Below 5 meters per, below 3 meters per second, actually, the turbine does not do any generation. So if the wind speed is below that and there is a change in wind direction, then the yawing is not done. So that, because even if the yawing is done, there won't be any generation. So such things are taken care of during the detection phase.
Right. Okay, I have a question from here. Good that we are on the same slide. I wanted to know, what is the reason of making a regression model? Was that not enough to just put error plots and find out what is what we really aspire to learn from this? And how much is the loss at what? Because we already have the actual or the predictive loss curves from the OEM.
So we have, so to know what should have been the generation and what actually is the generation, so there is a power curve, the ideal power curve that
which comes from the OEMs.
Yeah, but that is during the commission of the wind turbine, or and it does not take air density into consideration. It does not take the particular wind turbine's behavior into consideration. So over the years, the turbine's behavior could have changed, which is not taken into consideration by the ideal power curve. And hence we are.
So this power curve is generated based on the recent performance of this specific turbine, you say?
Yeah, it's turbine specific.
Okay, thanks. This is fine.
Hi.
Hi.
So how long before you can actually apply these algorithms? So when it's commissioned, it's obviously functioning at a rated curve.
Yeah.
Is it 3 months of data? Is it 6 months before you can actually start? And until then, probably the visual inspection models have to be applied, right?
Yeah, so the detection can be started off immediately. The identification, I mean, if there is a misalignment detected, the identification of root cause also can be done. For doing this quantification of energy, we would need at least 3 months of data to understand the recent behavior of the turbine. That is to train the model. If that is not available, the ideal power curve could be used, but then that would give out an error that is actually not attributable to this. Sorry.
One more. So just for my understanding, is there an automatic yawing mechanism already built into the?
Yeah. So there is a control system that takes the wind direction and the angle at which the turbine is facing, and it there is a feedback loop.
So this comes in when that is not functioning
as
designed. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Not really, because we need the sensor data to understand if there is a yaw misalignment. So this is to detect if the control mechanism is not doing what it is supposed to do properly.
Ma'am, I have a question.
Yeah, sure.
When you said to recommend a corrective action, you went through the historical maintenance data.
Mm-hmm.
So is the data properly structured onto your systems, and is there any format for maintenance that you log onto the system? Because we, I come from a company where the maintenance that has been done is mostly into the logbooks, and you have to extract data and feed into the system. So.
Yeah, actually, that's a very valid question. So maintenance data is never structured. I mean, in the industry, in this industry also, it is not structured. And the logs that we obtain are also not, you know, in a, so the SCADA data has a data pipeline, so it flows in. But the maintenance data needs to be requested for, and it's all manual. So it depends on the conversations that are had with the site team, and that's how we obtain the maintenance data.
So what was the criteria to supersede historical judgments? You said there is a criteria where you have, you can also supersede historical judgments that were taken.
Yes. So so in case there is yaw misalignment for a very small duration, but the quantification of energy is very high, but such a case was never seen in the past. So there is a flag that is raised, and then it is sent for human intervention. So these are, this is about a case which wasn't seen in the past. But then in to talk about a superseding of historical judgment. So take a case where an action was not taken, and it led to the failure, and that is a longer downtime as compared to a corrective action that's taken ahead of time. So that's the reason for having this superseding mechanism. Thank you.
We can have more questions.
Okay.
The next, unfortunately, we are unable to get the next speaker. He couldn't make it. We can continue the session. If you want to share more thoughts on your topic, you can.
Okay.
Okay. A similar type of event happens.
Okay, so
just debrief about a, maybe a case if it is not IP.
Yeah, surely. So the kind of recommendations that were given were to check the sensors and to have the control system checked, and recalibration of the sensors. And there was a case where there was a jammed motor, and that motor, yeah, the yawing motor was jammed and the teeth were broken. So such are so this is from the maintenance data that we know what kind of failures happen. And also there are engineers who have worked at site and come. So they also know, I mean, they also can do more suggestions based on this. So one is a so there is a sensor that is mounted on top of the turbine. I am so sorry, the laptop is switched off. So the nacelle of the turbine, there is a wind anemometer that is installed on top of that nacelle that measures the wind speed and direction. So that wind direction data is coming from that sensor. There is another sensor that is fit in the yaw mechanism of in the tower of the, I mean, where the yaw mechanism is, and there the angle of that yawing is there. So there are, basically these are the two different sensors placed at different positions in that turbine. And why do we need both? Is because, so when a turbine is facing the wind direction, and the wind direction changes, the turbine yaws, and then it changes back. So it does. So it has completed 360 degrees. So a turbine can maximum do that twice or four times, depending on the turbine's make. So that is there is a counter that is called cable twist counter. So once the turbine has yawed that many number of times, it has to untwist again, because the cables that are connected from the top of the nacelle till the bottom of the tower, those would have got twisted around it. So they need to be internally untwisted. So that's the reason why an additional sensor is required to measure that yaw angle as well.
So it's just comparing two data fields when you're talking about detection.
Yeah.
Is that that much about it for detection?
Yeah, detection is that along with the wind speed. So the wind speed needs to be above that cut-in wind speed.
Oh, that is the cutoff line, that's it.
Do you have any other use cases at BLP where you have applied analytics for different?
Yeah, actually, this is just one of the use cases in the wind energy. There are a lot more use cases. To just list down a few, wake effect is another issue that we look at. So since they said I have time, I could probably talk about that as well. So wake effect is that effect when a turbine in front, there's a turbine in the front and there's a turbine at the back. So like the image that we saw where there are three turbines, one after the other. So what happens is when the wind direction is coming, when the wind is coming and it's in one direction, that hits the first turbine. And that turbine would have consumed the energy and it will pass the wind to the second turbine. The second turbine would receive lesser wind speed than the first turbine. This is called wake effect. So a wake is being created at the back of the first turbine. So that is the upwind turbine, and there are downwind turbines as well. So so this is a problem that, there is no way to detect it visually or any other way. So the only way to detect is from the data. So from the data, is there a signature of wake that in a direction one turbine is generating more and that is causing generation to happen less in the downwind turbine? This is a very mathematically complex problem. That's because the turbines, the wind farms layout would not be, so there are farms that are rectangular, that is like a coordinate system where there are points at every square. There are farms like that, and there are farms that are not like that. So they have an irregular structure, like in hilly areas. If you drive from here to Hyderabad on the highway, on either left and right side of the highway, you could see a lot of wind turbines. They're all on top of hills. So the hill could also be contributing to the wake effect. So this is a complex problem. So the way in which it has been approached so far is through computational fluid dynamics. So to understand the patterns of the wind as and when they interact with, say, the mountain or the tip of the blade, how is that causing vortices at the end of the tip of the blades, how are they causing vortices at behind it when they are interacting with the wind? So this is the way it has been traditionally looked at. We are trying to see if machine learning can be applied here and understand if there is wake effect and also quantify how much is the loss that is happening. And this is actually also an optimization problem. So an entire farm consisting of around 35 to 50 turbines is owned by one single farm owner. So the optimization problem for the farm owner would be the farm should be able to generate maximum. It's irrespective of whether it is getting generated from turbine 1 or turbine 2. It doesn't matter for him. So a combination of that wake effect and this optimization problem at farm level, all of this combined, implemented using machine learning. Yeah, this one is at the designing stage. Sure. Yaw. Controlled yaw. Yawing. Yawing is the control. So in order to ensure that the wake doesn't happen, yaw can be controlled.
So what? You said that there are turbines one behind the other at a certain distance.
Yeah.
Why can't we have a W sort of a pattern where the paths of the wind do not really intersect for two turbines, and or at least they have a minimum distance where the air can come back to form a normal AFO pattern. Until then, you can have the next one in a W pattern.
Like the turbines have the degree of freedom to turn towards the direction of the wind. So even if the turbines were at a W pattern, when the wind is coming in the direction of that, the tilt of that W, the first turbine would become the upwind and the second would become the downwind turbine. So, yeah. So that's not the wind direction is not constant. Yeah. Yes. And that in that case, this turbine becomes upwind and the other one becomes downwind. And to answer the question about why can't we have, the turbines far apart so that this does not happen, the theoretical limit is 5 diameters of the rotor. So the rotor's diameter, 5 diameters away from it, it's said that the wake effect will not be very pronounced. But there is a farm in Denmark where it has been placed at 10 diameters, much beyond the theoretical limit. And there has been a very clear wake effect that was visually seen in that farm. So one day, two pilots were just going in a helicopter and they just looked at that farm. That farm is offshore, so it's in the ocean. So they just look down and then they see that their entire area is covered with fog. And the wake effect could be visually seen. So the fog is being churned by the first turbine, and that foggy wind is going to the second turbine. And it was a very clear visual representation of how the wake was happening.
Hey, since you said this is in design stage,
yeah.
So what is the cost estimated for this implementation and the maintenance after that?
Implementation of,
implementation of the solution.
Yeah.
And the maintenance.
Maintenance of.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, but are you talking about the implementation of this?
Solution, yes.
Solution.
Yes.
In terms of, okay. So we are actually, I'm coming from a company called BLP. So we are a team of data scientists and few of us are working on it. And when you say implementation costs, does that mean how much long are we going to work on this?
Or no. Giving out to the users,
okay.
Implementing it,
yeah.
And what would be the cost which for the user?
Expected
costs.
Okay, so our company actually has a portal, has actually a web application that is used to monitor the performance of the wind turbines, and we also do analytics on that and give out alerts. So all of this would be a part of that.
Okay.